For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Welcome to This Awakened Generation with your host, Mazinu Abraham Egbuoku.
So, another thing about the nature of death is that it can come suddenly. That's, to me, this is one of the most frightful things that I have discovered about death. And I kind of coined an adage. I said, I've been preaching this for decades, or the last 2 decades. We are all standing at the edge of eternity. And any of us can be pushed over at any time. Any of us. So you and I, we are standing at the very edge. So don't think that because I don't have any health challenge today, I don't have anything. If you get all these things right, and you know the mystery of light, this, you remember when we started this, our online sessions at the beginning of the pandemic, I started with a scripture in Luke and chapter 12. I want to read that scripture again. And it will tie into everything that we're talking about lately. So I just want us to put our perspective in order. Put our perspective, you know, get your focus. I felt, you know, that God would have us put our perspective, you know, the right perspective. Don't get carried away. You know, understand what we are here for. You know, Luke chapter 12 from verse 15 to 21. And he said to them, I'm reading 15 to 21, Luke 12, thank you. And he spoke a parable to them, saying, The ground of a certain man, 15 tells me, you know, take heed and beware of covetousness. I don't want to remove that one before I start reading the Bible. So first 15, he says, and he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Because this is the foundation that led him to the parable. That because a man's life does not consist of the things he possesses. God help me. Can we pray? Because this, I don't want this to pass you by. A man's life, are you living because of possessions? Is this what you're living for? Is this what you wake up for every day? I'm sorry, you're driven wrong. This is, you're going to end up, you know, a dangerous eternity. I'm telling you, you're not going to live life. You're not going to live the life you're supposed to live. You can, don't get carried away by these things. Don't get a man's life. Jesus, he says, a wiser than Solomon has come. The wisest, the wisdom of God. Bible says he is the wisdom of God, and the wisdom of God is wiser than the wise, greatest wisdom of. In fact, the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of the wisest man. And he's telling you and I that take heed. Don't allow your life to be fashioned after just the pursuit of things. A man's life does not come. You're going to be so miserable if your whole life is about the pursuit of things. That's what he's saying to us. Beware of covetousness, the lust, the insatiable lust for things. I want this, I want that, I want that. If that's the basis of your life, God wants you to find your life to be founded on the pursuit of him. And then any other thing becomes secondary. You have to be honest to yourself today. I'm talking to you as a brother to brother, brother to sister today. You have to be honest with yourself today. Is your life founded on things? I had a family devotion with my wife and this week, And that was one of the things we did. We sat down to ask ourselves, really, you know, like the scripture says, examine yourselves. You know, where are we in our life, in our ministry, in our business, in our marriage, with our parenting, with our relationships? Where are we, and where does God want us to be? So that, you know, I don't want to be taken by surprise. I want this life to upgrade myself all the time in God. Do you know that many of us in our businesses, we are doing it? Yes, some of us have master's degree. We have 2 master's degree. We have done certification in this. You're always upgrading yourself in your career. You're upgrading yourself to do a better business, but you're not upgrading yourself in God. And yet you say you are pursuing God. You are deceiving yourself. You're not really pursuing God. You must seek Him. You must wait for Him. You must upgrade yourself in God. Get another degree in God. Go deeper in God. Get something deeper. Get something deeper. Sit down. Do that evaluation that Neka and I did this last week. Do it. Start the process. Call your spouse, your children. Where are we? Who are we? You know, let's measure ourselves. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I think 31, 32, maybe 33, 32. It says, judge yourself so that you will not be condemned with the world. That's what it says. Judge yourself so that you will not be condemned with the world. Thank you. It says, for if we judge ourselves, we will not be judged. Remember I said, and what it means by them is we will not be condemned. Because what it's saying is that, remember, I told you, it is appointed for every man to die once. After that is judgment. But it says now, if we are judging ourselves, don't let anybody deceive you. You must contemplate death now. Judge yourself. Am I living right for God? Am I living right? If I cross over, you know, one of the worst things Satan has done is to make the mystery of eternity water it down so that people are, I already have Jesus Christ. I'm going to heaven. It's not true. Many will say, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name? Did I not cast out devils in your name? You be careful. Don't be wrong on the with eternity. I was telling a friend who claims to be an atheist. I was saying to him, I said, look, my brother, let me just tell you straight up. You can't afford to be wrong on this matter. Because if you're wrong, the consequences are too dangerous. You don't wish the consequences for the worst person on this earth. If we judge ourselves, we will not be condemned. But when we are judged, we are chastised of the Lord. We are chastened by the Lord. So you see that? When you sit down and you start judging yourself harshly, and you say, with the word of God, or not with carnal stuff, with the word of God, this is what God wants for me. I mean, look at one of the things we said, and that's one of the things I plan to share with you today. We said, what does God want from us? And that's part of what I want to talk about today. That was why I first called my wife to talk about it to her, because that's what God was speaking to me to share. I said, this is what is in my spirit. So, what does God want from us? What does God want from us? God wants from us, in Revelation chapter 4, verse 11, it says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power, for thou hast created all things for thy pleasure. They were created. God wants us to bring pleasure to Him. He wants to be the center of our lives. He wants our pursuit. He wants life, the meaning of life, to be Him. Can I say that again? He wants, when we say, what is the meaning of life? God wants your meaning of life to be God, to be Jesus Christ. I look around me, sometimes when I see somebody who has died, and I'm not judging another person unrighteously, I just look around. I see someone who has died. Even surrounding their death, you can know how they live. You, if you see the razzmatazz around them, you see people, there's no Christ much. It's all about how they made money, how big they were, how high and mighty they were. You know, you don't see that. And I just pray that they rest in peace. May their soul rest in peace. Your life, by the time you're going, Everybody should know this person's life was around God, was around Christ. Your life had the meaning, and that meaning was Christ. It was for me to live is Christ, and then to die is gain. The meaning of your life must be Christ. So you must judge yourself so that we are not condemned with the world. You must. Don't live carelessly. Live contemplating eternity. Hallelujah. So it's appointed for every man to die once after that judgment. So let's go back to our original portion that we're reading in Luke. It says, so take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life does not consist of the things that he, abundance of things that he possesses. Now let me tell you something. Many people don't like to hear this. In fact, this morning, and I woke up again and I said, God, I'm going to share this word you've put in my heart. I just said to myself, I mean, I was having a conversation, I believe, with the Holy Spirit. And I was saying, you know, and I just felt that the Lord was telling me, many don't want to hear this, but be consistent. Be consistent. Just say the truth. Say the truth and say it and leave me to do my work. So I'm just going to say, not win a popularity contest. I may not have people, you know, thousands of people, you know, looking for me, but those who hear his voice, you will hear his words. That's what Jesus in John 6 or 7. He was saying to them, look, let me tell you something. If you hear these words that I'm speaking to you, then you know that you're a child of God. So let's go. It says, take heed and beware of covetousness, for one, a man's life does not consist of the things that he possesses. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought to himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns, you know, pursuit of just building, you know, doing well in life. I will build a greater barn. I will store my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods, you know, laid up for you. You have many goods laid up for you for many years. Take ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this night, oh boy, this night, your soul will be required of you. Then whose will these things be that you have provided? So it is with him who lays up treasure and is not rich towards God. Wow, God bless you. I say this, so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. This, when you finish this whole race and you imagine you are taken suddenly. Imagine you are taken suddenly. You just have to leave. Nobody, most people don't contemplate that you could leave suddenly. Imagine if you left suddenly. You fool. That's what I'm not the one who said it, though, because the Bible says I shouldn't call a man a fool, but I can call the person that God called a fool. This is the fool. The fool is not rich towards God. That means was the whole essence. Our vision statements as a church, our vision statement, River River Church, like I've been teaching our leaders, is to be rich towards God. And to raise a generation that is rich towards God. This is where our vision statement comes from. The whole essence, the whole meaning of my life, to live Christ means to be rich towards God. So I want to pray as I'm going forward that in the name of Jesus, everyone who is listening, that God will grant you great grace to desire to be rich towards him. Because you are already blessed if you have that desire. If you don't, then God has to work in your heart and he can do it. And I trust God for that miracle in your life. Because there's nothing like it when it naturally comes from you to be rich towards God. Just like it was with Enoch. It says Enoch, he loved God so much. He trusted God so much. Just like it was with David. These people just love God from day one. They just love him. God, give me a heart to just love you and to desire you that my whole life. You're blessed. When you are rich towards God, you're blessed. Oh God, because your pursuit is different. It's different. If I when I see people, I'm in so many groups and so many different circles, and people are not rich towards God. I just feel sad for them. I pray for them. I just have compassion. That your life is just going and you're thinking of what to eat. In fact, funny enough, you will find out when you are rich towards God, a lot of these things that the Gentiles are seeking after, God is even going to give it to you. Once he's sure that you need it and you can handle it, he gives them to you. So you don't need, we need to be rich towards God. He needs to be the center of our focus. You are blessed, thank you, Neka, when you are rich towards God. Hallelujah. So this eating and making merry and celebrating and then partying and everybody knows you because you are a fella's friend or Sunday Ade or whatever. This is not the meaning of life. The meaning of your life is Christ, is to be rich towards God. Because you will cross over. You will cross over. Death is certain. It is appointed for every man to die. It is appointed for every man to die, and afterwards is judgment from judgment. So what does God want from us? I told you first and foremost, Revelation chapter 4 verse 11. What does it mean to be rich towards God? Revelation chapter 4 11. Thou art worthy, O Lord. It couldn't be clearer than that. To receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things for your pleasure. They were created. Everything, you are created for the pleasure of God. Is your life bringing pleasure to God? Do you know what it means to bring pleasure to God? Because if not, can you imagine? I was listening to a documentary or a message the other day. A man who said he went to hell. 23 minutes in hell. Feel free to Google it. 23 minutes in hell. I posted it on my Facebook page one of these days. 23 minutes in hell. He spent 23 minutes in hell. So he was trying to explain that. Some people complain that, everybody's going to go to heaven. He says, no. He says, if somebody, a stranger, walks into your house now and knocks at the door and says, come, because your house is big and beautiful and you're a kind man, please let me just let you in. You probably, a person you don't know, you probably won't let them in because you don't know who they are. Especially if the person looks, like they were against you. They are fighting against you. They are, enmity with you. He says, so it is. When we cross over to eternity, we cannot just go and knock at heaven's door if you have not walked with God as you should. You can't. He's not going to welcome you. It's the relatives of Christ, of God, that are coming there. Those who know him, the close relatives, close affiliates, people who have already been walking with him before. So understand that all of this one we are doing here is so temporal. It is so temporal. Please, I beg of you. It's so temporal. Understand. Understand. The other day, a gentleman passed on to be with the Lord, to die. And it's so clear. I mean, you can't judge a man's heart, but it's so clear that this man has walked with the Lord. I couldn't even mourn. I was thankful. I was sad that he's gone. It just reminds me of when my mom passed and went to be the Lord. I'm sad, but I'm excited because I know where she is by the grace of God. Let us be able to say so about your life, please. Let us be able to let and listen. Not just that. Do you want to go to heaven itself and be a low level pauper forever? Let's even assume you cross over, you don't go to hell. But Jesus taught these things. He says that it's better for somebody. Do you know that scripture? Before I even go into that, I need to drop the scripture. Mark chapter 9. Pastor Roe, help me. I think it's in the 40s, is it in the 30s or 40s? where, yeah, I think in the 40s, 45, thereabouts. If your hand causes you to sin, just go and cut it off. It is better. These are messages that people think, Jesus preached this, and we should preach Jesus' messages. Don't run away. If you're listening to me today, don't run away. Listen to it and let it touch your life so that you can align yourself aright. Today is a day of alignment, as it were. The Holy Spirit will have you align yourself. Wait on the Lord. Wait for God. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. And you know, align yourself to what He's saying. Yes, thank you, Stella. It says, and if your foot offends you, in other words, if your foot causes you to sin, if your eyes cause you to sin, he says, cut it off. That's how serious this matter is. And some people say that it's not literal. It's literal, I beg, in a sense. In other words, if you find out that this foot of yours, there's nothing you can do again. There's no grace. Of course, there's grace. You can find grace. So he's saying, go and get grace. But if you don't get grace, and you know that the only way to make sure this thing stops leading you to offend God is to cut it off, then better go and do it too. If it's a boyfriend, if it's a woman, if it's man, if it's whatever, if it's money, if it's business, just get rid of these things. Don't toy with your eternity. That's what he's saying. He's telling you, take it very seriously. Don't toy. That's the bottom line of that. If your foot offends you, cut it off. It is better for you to enter hell, enter halt into life. That's enter into life. That's everlasting life. Than having 2 feet and be cast to hell. Oh, how many people today have been cast into hell with 2 feet and 2 eyes and billions of naira in their accounts? Years ago, I heard of a man who died with $300 million plus, not naira, dollars plus. $300 million plus, but he's dead. He died in his 40s. So what now? So what after that now? What are you talking about? He says, in this hell, it doesn't end there. This maggot will eat your body, will never be consumed. I have to tell you, I'm sorry. We're in such a woke culture and woke era that people don't want to hear anything that seems negative. You have to, the fear of God and the fear of hell should also affect you. Don't go to hell. Don't take it for granted. Don't allow the spirit of the time. They are trying to make it, worldly people. Don't mind them. They are just making us. There's no heaven. There's no whatever. All right. Don't toy with your eternity, because you will cross over. Anything that is affecting you, anything that is standing on your way, anything that is holding you back, anything that is preventing you, please get rid of it. Hallelujah. So, understand this. God wants you to seek Him. He wants to be the object of your affection. He wants your life to be built around Jesus Christ. Not about worldly acclaim. Some people's life is worldly acclaim. How people celebrate you, have the best dress, the best things, the best shoes, and so on. Nonsense things. You know, I just don't understand this. You know, please be delivered in Jesus' name. Be known for God. Be known. It's not only say no about your pastor, not about pastor. Some pastors are not even known for God. Do you know that? It's true. Look around you. When you see certain ministers, I'm not putting anybody, I'm just telling you facts. I'm not mentioning any name. Look around you. When you think of certain ministers, what comes to your mind? And I'm throwing in broadly, not just ministers, Christians, but I want to use ministers because in many cases, to show you how there's such a loss of focus and identity, one of the first things, if you see a man of God, I was in a church, in a dear friend's church in Abuja, and as I came up, you know, people started clapping for me, and so I said to them, and they were so blessed by it, I said to them, you know, please, I hope you're clapping for me because you think that you look at me, you're seeing holiness or you're seeing righteousness or contentment or simplicity. You know, because if you clap because you think this person has money or this person is dressed well, He says, woe, it's woe unto the church. It's a shame. It's a shame. They called Noah, he says, preachers of righteousness. We were attached to righteousness, not prosperity, not all these things. When you see a child of God, their identity should be attached to them of holiness. A true child of God, the first thing you must see is something that speaks of God. If you are truly seeking God, something that speaks of God, something of the fruit of the Spirit, something of the life of God. Your life must reflect something of the holy identity, because we're a holy nation, we're a royal priesthood, we're perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. This is our identity. This is our identity. So, you know, when you see some of these people, both ministers, some of the ministers, the first thing you think about is money they are dressing. I wish you knew. Please, minister, please, child of God, you should go back to your altar of prayer and cry to God, break me. You're not yet broken. Because if your whole life is about first thing, if do a sample for yourself. You as a child of God, you as a minister. So when you go around as a minister and people think of this person has a big dress in so well, is the best dresser in the world. Please go and be broken. Go and cry to God. Be so sad about your life. When you go around and people, the first thing, particularly that first thing. My worst, one of my worst woes is that the first thing that anybody will think of me as is that I'm a rich person. I hate it. I hate it with every tender being of my bone and every bone marrow of my being and every biscuit bone in my body. I hate it with everything. I don't want to be known. I don't want to be known to be a rich person. I don't want to be known to be a good dresser. I don't want any of that. I want to be known as a holy man. I want to be known as a loving man of God. I want to be known as a kind person. Something that reflects of God. This is how I know I'm pursuing God truly and He's my priority in life. This is how I know. So, that's what it means. The first thing is that God wants you to serve Him. I mean, I've talked about that. God wants you to serve Him. That's what it means to bring pleasure. If you don't bring pleasure to God, to bring pleasure means to serve Him.
Tree by the River is more than just a church. It's God's vision. It's God's vision for the times that we're living in. I'm a part of the vision. You should be a part of it. Join us.